Welcome to the Knife Junkie Podcast, your weekly dose of knife news and information about knives and knife collecting. Here's your hosts, Jim Person and Bob the Knife Junkie DeMarco.
Hello, Knife Junkie, and welcome to episode number 89 of the Knife Junkie Podcast. I'm Jim Person.
And I'm Bob DeMarco. Welcome to the show.
The Knife Junkie Podcast is the place for knife newbies and knife junkies to learn about knives and knife collecting. It's our midweek supplemental episode where Bob gets a chance to dive deep into some of the knife stories and tell us what's going on there. We've got four stories to cover in Knife Life News this week, plus a tip of the week talking about rust. Boo, hiss, rust, bad. Yeah. We don't want to see that. No. So going to get some tips from Bob about rusted blades and a rusted pivot, and also get an update on the Cold Steel Voyager Chris. So we'll see what's going on there. But first, let's dive into the Knife Life News.
You're listening to the Knife Junkie Podcast. And now here's the Knife Junkie with the Knife Life News.
So most of us know the Reich Knife Hummingbird. It was a sort of a proof of chops knife that came out by Reich Knife, a very high-end, very high-tech manufacturer out of China. They do a lot of extremely intricate milling, biomechanical designs in their handles and such. Well, their Hummingbird was one of the first knives they came out with, and it was a tiny little almost 4-inch knife, and that's open. It was a folder, tiny blade, but extremely intricate handle, sort of mimicking carved, you know, with milling carved out, mimicking a wing. In any case, this tiny little jewel of a knife has been upgraded to a daily carry sort of EDC style knife. It's called the Hummingbird Plus. And Hummingbird Plus to me seems like an entree, like a Reich Knife entree into the more reasonably priced knives that people who carry knives and use them on a daily basis might be willing to spend. That being said, I'm not exactly sure what the price of this is, but you can tell from the materials, N690 for the blade, and G10 or carbon fiber on the, yes, liner lock frame. So no titanium and no high-end steels. So this is taking a great design. That little tiny Hummingbird, you know, like I said before, was kind of like a little jewel. Usable, but tiny. This is taking a very nice design, bringing it to sort of a hand-sized model and getting it in more hands. Mm-hmm. So I'm looking forward to seeing that.
Okay. Well, sounds like it was a appropriately named knife since it's so small and the Hummingbird is small. So that kind of name makes sense.
Exactly.
As opposed to some of the other names you've thrown at me over the past, you know, months.
We at some point, we're going to have a conversation about naming knives.
Right.
But the one thing I want to say, this is exciting to me because Reich Knife was always kind of a little bit out of reach in terms of their opulent knives are beautiful and I'd like to experience them, but they're not something I want to spend top dollar for. This, however, looks like something I would spend money on. So mm-hmm. It looks pretty cool.
Okay. So next up in Knife Life News, a knife company I always have a hard time saying it. Opinel Knives?
Opinel, yeah.
Opinel Knives, okay.
You could say Opinel, but I think... Yeah. The French say Opinel in this French. Okay.
Well, I will go with Opinel. So anyway, aftermarket deep carry pocket clip that you want to speak about?
Yeah, this is interesting because the Opinel is a classic, very inexpensive knife that have been around for 100 some odd years. They're French farmer's knives. They have these very inexpensive round wooden handles, and they're great for EDC because they are super light and sharp and easy to sharpen. However, they kind of stink for EDC because they have no clip and the handle is perfectly circular. So it'll inevitably end up falling sideways at the bottom of your pocket and it just sort of bulges out in uncomfortable ways. But someone named Anatoly Olemchenko, a product designer, has come out with a Kickstart project for something called the Clipinel. It's a clip. Yes, it's a clip that fits in a friction sort of way over the viro block, which is the locking collar, the rotating locking collar at the pivot of an Opinel. It fits right on that, locks on it, and takes the place of the lock, and it allows you to carry it sort of in a deep carry way. looks interesting. Right now they're making them for the 7, 8, and 9, the three most popular sizes. As you know, Opinel goes up to 13, 13 being the most gigantic and manly of the Opinel knives. As you can see, I'm saying Opinel, Opinel, like I say, Bowie and Bowie.
That's right. Well, you're pleasing everybody.
Yeah, I need someone to come and correct me.
Right, right. And me as well.
Yeah. So one downside to this, some people might find, it orients your knife naturally, tip down. A lot of people bristle at that, but the Opinel is a different style knife. So, you know, there's very little chance of this thing coming open in your pocket.
Well, and as I learned from a lunch that I had with the Knife Junkie last week, there's only one correct answer to that question, and it is tip up, correct?
That is correct. If you ask me, unless you've got this knife I have right next to me, which is either the Spyderco Military, which I can excuse it on, and the Microtech SOCOM Elite. Those are the two knives I'm willing to accept tip down.
So it's one of those, this is the way it should be, except in these cases.
Yeah, exactly.
All right.
There's always an exception.
Absolutely. All right. Well, we look forward to hearing more about that Kickstarter campaign, which we've had a couple of stories here on the podcast about Kickstarter campaigns in the knife industry. So always an interesting story from that standpoint, as well as about what the product is.
Yeah, it seems like a good way to do it. So you know that there are actually people who want to buy that product. You're not taking a total gamble.
Right.
It's a calculated risk.
Right, right. Another story in the Knife Life News, Hinderer Jurassic. I love that name.
Yes.
Three-way pivot upgrade.
Yes, indeed. It's yet another Hinderer model that's going through the tri-way pivot upgrade. The Hinderer Jurassic is the knife that came out a couple years back to fill the gap between the 3-inch XM18 and the 3.5-inch XM18. The Jurassic is a really cool-looking knife. Comes in at a 3.25-inch blade, which is always... I'm happy about, Jim, because it doesn't tempt me. That blade size just does not tempt me, but the design does. So if they made this in a 4-inch or, you know, something like that, I would have to get it. But anyway, they're going through the Gen 2 now of the Jurassic, and they're doing a couple of updates. Chief among them is the tri-way pivot. That's something Hinderer came up with a few years back, where they offer, they started with the XM18. They offer the three different pivots, three different mechanisms for that pivot. You can have the Nylatron washers, the Phosphor Bronze washers, or ball bearing washers. And so you get three different kinds of actions and three different kinds of robustness, if you will. And you can change according to your needs or your whim or your mood. And I think that's a cool thing. It's also coming with 20 CV as opposed to the previous models, S35VN. And it's also coming with a steel lock interface, steel lock bar interface, which to me, I love it when I don't have to see it. I like that they exist, and I like that they are there keeping most knives lock up where they need to be. But it's always so pleasing when you come across a knife like my new Les George V-Sep first generation, which has just absolutely perfect lockup, no lock bar interface. So in any case, that's coming out from the new Hinderer, and this also has a modular backspacer. So I have to say that I will probably pass on the Jurassic just due to the size, but I got to say it looks beautiful. And when they do the tri-way upgrade to the Maximus, when they do Maximus 2.0 and they put the tri-way in there, I will be first in line. Mm-hmm. Maximus, Jim, is the one that it's the double-edged dagger. Mm-hmm. And he's one of the few people to make those.
I had a question about the Jurassic. You said it kind of fit in between the XM18 and I didn't catch the other one. So it's in between two different XMs, the size of it?
Yeah, the XM18 comes in a 3-inch blade and a 3.5-inch blade.
Okay.
Some people find the 3-inch, just in general, some people find 3-inch too small. They do it right under 3 inches, so it's legal in most jurisdictions where 3-inch blades are legal. And 3.5, and to some people, that's just too big. You know, so 3.25, when you're dealing with small dimensions like that, the difference of a quarter of an inch does have a ripple effect all the way around the design,
right?
Substantially, shrinks it.
Right. Well, I'm going to ask a question here that I'm sure you won't know the answer, but you know, maybe somebody does. why did they make another knife that fit that? Why not just have an XM 3, 3 1/4, 3 1/2?
Interesting. I don't know.
I mean, maybe they needed another knife, another brand, another model. They had the design. I don't know. Just a curiosity question.
Yeah, I would speculate, because I like to do that, that maybe he just had an itch and he wanted to make that design. He's like, where would this fit?
Mm-hmm.
You know, maybe the design was already there and just found a spot. I can't imagine that there was, you know, a huge hue and cry for a knife to go between the 3 and the 3 1/2 inch. But hey, man, why not create the need? And people know, you know, 3.25, 3 1/4 inch blade is very, very popular size.
Hmm. Okay. All right. Well, last story, but probably, dare I say, the more significant story in Knife Life News. Manly Knives starts off the new year closing the doors in the USA.
Yeah, well, yeah, it's interesting. It's the Bulgarian knife company called Manly Knives. They came on my radar with a slip joint called the Wasp. And that was very cool. And then a beautiful, slender, slicey EDC, sort of in the tradition of the Spyderco Endura, but a substantially different knife. And another knife called the Comrade, a larger, slightly larger slip joint knife. Well, they came out with a new knife to start the year called the Manly Blaze, as in Trailblazer. It's an outdoor knife, and it comes in either D2 or a sort of premium version in CPM 154, G10 handle scales, or smooth walnut. It's a 4 1/2 inch blade. It's a beautiful looking thing. And with that announcement, they also announced they are closing the doors of Manly USA, which is the United States distribution arm for Manly Knives, which is a Bulgarian company. And instead, what they're doing is opening something called Maker's Knives, which will be a small batch showcase for Bulgarian knife makers, which is very interesting to me. I thought that Manly Knives was doing kind of very well among the EDC crowd here, just from watching Kevin Cleary's videos and I believe Nick Shabazz did a video, and several others very enthusiastic about the performance of the Peak. That's their one that's sort of like a Spyderco knife. And so that being said, I'm just surprised that they're pulling that aspect of it. But anyway, it'll be interesting to see what Bulgaria and Bulgarian knife makers have to offer. We've had a guest on this show, Alex Tissot, who's very interested in collecting knives from makers on the up and, you know, up and coming makers. And oftentimes they're from Eastern Bloc countries. So I'm interested to see what Bulgaria has to offer outside of the traditional Manly designs.
Anything in the press release of the story? I mean, did they cite any reasons? Was it financial, just production, just because they wanted to?
No, they do not. They do not say what those reasons are. They only say what they're going to turn it into, which is a positive way to spin the story. I mean, one can only imagine it just wasn't worth their while, the way it was set up. I hope that doesn't make these knives like the Peak, the Wasp, and the Comrade unavailable. Hopefully we can just buy them from a Bulgarian distributor.
Well, more of the Knife Junkie podcast coming up, but I do want to remind you that if you have an opinion on any of these stories, or if you have more info on any of these stories, be sure to leave a comment on the listener line at 724-466-4487. That's 724-466-4487. Love to get your feedback, your inside knowledge, whatever it is. Leave us a comment on your recorded line there, and we can play it back on an upcoming episode of the Knife Junkie Podcast.
And now that we're caught up with Knife Life News, let's hear more of the Knife Junkie Podcast.
Back on the Knife Junkie Podcast, episode number 89. Bob the Knife Junkie DeMarco here. I'm Jim Person. Thanks for joining us on the Knife Junkie Podcast. Hope you're enjoying it. Please consider giving us a rating or a review. We'd love to get some honest feedback on what you like about the show, don't like about the show, and share it with a friend.
Bob and Jim will have more of the Knife Junkie Podcast in a minute. But now, here's this week's Tip of the Week.
All right. Tip of the Week, Bob. Some news that we can use, if you will, and it's got to do with that bad old thing called rust.
Yes. Well, there are two tips, actually. So recently I was doing my cold steel collection videos and noticed on a few of the knives I hadn't opened in a little while that some rust had settled in. And I was shocked. I was like, what? I take good care of these things. You know, I felt a little betrayed. But anyway, I found that mostly this was happening on bead blasted, some of my older Aus 8 blades. For instance, the Raja 2 and the Spartan. Those both have bead blasted blades, at least the ones I did. I got first generation because I was way into them before anybody else.
Absolutely.
No, I'm just kidding. Now they make them in stonewash. Anyway, I got them with the bead blast. And as you may or may not know, when you bead blast something, what you're doing is taking thousands and thousands of thousands of these tiny little balls of medium and shooting them at high speeds against the metal. And it gives it that nice subdued look. Some people like it, some people don't like it, but it gives it a subdued look. When you look at it in under a microscope, you will see that there are millions of little pits on that surface, and that's what kind of knocks down the gloss of the steel. Those little pits are susceptible to rust, especially if you don't use the thing often and there's humidity introduced, which apparently there was. You know, sometimes we'll have a party and people, oh, can I see your knives? And I'll show people my knives, and then I'll forget to, you know, they'll open everyone up with their grubby, greasy hands. And
how dare they?
No, I'm just kidding. And I will forget to wipe them down. And so sometimes that leads to rust. Well, steel wool, a very light gauge or not coarse gauge, fine gauge of steel wool and mineral oil will handle that if you don't want to get rid of the if you don't want to get rid of the bead blast finish. You don't want to worry at it, and you don't want to add a lot of pressure, but just put the oil on there and lightly rub it out, and try and go with any sort of grain that might be present. But if it's adequately bead blasted, there will be no grain, and that oil should take care of it. Now, what I do, because I'm not particularly fond of the bead blast finish, is I will take some very light sandpaper and just sand the whole blade. And it does two things. It eliminates a lot of those pits, those micro pits, makes it smoother, less susceptible to rust, while at the same time giving it a sort of weathered look that I really like. So around the grind lines or around the grind lines, it will be a little darker, a little lighter, because it's a peak in the topography of the blade, so it's getting a little bit more abrasion. And it just makes the knife look cool, and it sort of highlights the grind.
Well, I think you answered my question. I was going to ask you if you like the bead blasted finish, but I kind of take it from that response you just gave that you maybe bought them when they were introduced and popular, but you've kind of changed your tune about liking the bead blast.
Yeah, it's very rare that you'll see a bead blast on a high-end knife. And now it escapes me, but one recently did come out that had a bead blast, and I was a little bit shocked, and now I can't remember what it is. Maybe someone could write in and let us know what that is. Steel wool and mineral oil, or straight up fine sandpaper if you want to change the look of the blade.
So you said two tips in one. You were talking about rusted blades, but also the pivots, which can rust as well?
Yes. Okay, so I have this bad habit, Jim, of leaving the sunroof of my car popped up, you know, not all the way open, but the vent popped up.
Okay.
And I park backwards in the driveway. The driveway slopes down, so when we have rain, water comes in.
It goes. Yep.
It goes right where I keep my little Buck Solo slip joint in the console of the car. It's a little kind of do everything small slip joint knife, cheap little guy, but I love it. Got a nice bone handle, and I don't want anything to happen to it. Well, I take pretty good care of that little knife. The other day, I took it out to use it, and I could barely... Well, okay, so that's an exaggeration. It was harder to open than usual. Some rust had formed in that pivot in the last several weeks when water had come in the last time, and I hadn't checked or noticed. And so this has happened to me before, and I was trying to remember what my procedure was. And so this is what I did. I took the little knife. It's a little knife, so you can, you know, do this. You might not want to immerse a whole knife in alcohol like I'm about to do, but you can definitely do this with the pivot on a slip joint. So I laid the whole thing in a dish of alcohol for a few minutes, and then pulled it out of the alcohol, opened it and closed it, opened it and closed it a bunch of times, and dried it off. Okay. And then I took some compressed air, you know, like the kind you use to
clean
computers.
To dry it out, yeah.
Exactly. Blast it out with that. And then I blast in some gun oil. I think it's Hopes number 9. But anything that's a high friction or thin kind of oil, put it in there and do the same thing. Open, close, open, close, open, close. And then I put it back in the alcohol, blast it again. And you can see that that what comes out is now much lighter. Mm. I did that one more time with this, and then I was like, okay, well, this isn't a GEC. Maybe for a GEC, I keep going with this and do it a couple more times. But really, that opening and closing motion, and then the alcohol, oil, and compressed air really cleaned it out, and it's right. Pretty much back to normal.
Okay. So I don't know much about chemistry, metal reactions, that type of thing, but it's the alcohol, I'm assuming, that starts eating at the rust or loosening up the rust. And then when you spray the gun oil in, it gets lubricated and helps wash it away and blowing the air in there, blah, blah, blah.
Yeah, I think really the greatest thing is the friction of the opening and closing.
Oh, okay.
does the most, because this is this does not have washers. So this is the blade tang right against the liners. So there's nothing in the middle there. If you can get enough liquid and oil in there and open and close that friction and then blast it out, wipe it down, you're going to be able to get in between those surfaces. Right.
Well, I would definitely be interested in hearing Knife Junkie podcast listeners' experiences of what they do if they happen to experience rust on either their blades or their pivots. Please, love to hear from you. What's your solution? 724-466-4487. 724-466-4487, or shoot Bob an email at bob@thenifejunkie.com and let us know your solutions, whether it's an inexpensive solution or you have an expensive one that you'd like to share. We'd love to hear from you about that.
Great info on this week's Tip of the Week. And now back to the Knife Junkie podcast.
All right, Bob, moving on. Final kind of thing you wanted to talk about. Cold Steel Voyager Chris. We were hoping you would have it, but alas, you're disappointed.
Yes, yes. Okay. On and on with my first world problems. But this was kind of a buzzkill, I got to say. I ordered the Cold Steel Voyager Chris from Knife Center, my favorite and longest used knife purveyor online. And I saw a little thing, ships in 2 to 3 days.
Ooh,
and
okay.
I thought, 2 to 3 days, huh? Like, why would it be 2 to 3 days? If they had it on hand, they could ship it the next day. If they didn't have it on hand, I'm betting it's going to take longer than 2 or 3 days to get to Knife Center to come to me. But I was like, you know, I don't care. I just want to, I want to get on this. And then as I, you know, press the go button, it says, you know, this, you know, are you patient? This could take a couple of days. Are you ready? And I was like, yeah, I can handle it. Kind of knowing that if it's actually just a couple, 2-3 days, then I will be surprised and happily so. And then a couple of days go by, and then a week goes by, and my brother emails me. He's like, oh, I got my Voyager Chris, but Knife Center said it's going to take a couple of days. And I was like, shh, brother, it's going to take a long right, couple right. of days. And then yesterday I get this contrite email. Hey, man, sorry, but, you know, holdups from the manufacturer. We just don't have it. We can either refund your money or you want to just keep the order the same. And I'm like, of course I'm going to keep the order the same. Just leave the order. But come on, I knew you didn't have that damn knife. Just be straight up with me. Now I'm not calling Knife Center not straight up. They have always been, you know, right on and awesome. But that's just me and my anticipation and my expectation getting the best of me. I knew exactly what I was getting into when I purchased that, especially when they had that special window pop up. Are you patient? Are you going to be patient? It might be 2 or 3 days.
Okay. Well, maybe you know, you never know what happens with manufacturing, shipping, logistics. I mean, you know, maybe they were anticipating it at a certain date, and then, you know, who knows? And, you know, where's that knife being made? I'm wondering.
Oh, I'm assuming it's in Taiwan. Okay. Oh gosh, don't tell me it's being held up internationally. All right. Well, we'll get to that another time.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I was thinking China because of the I've heard a lot of stories about you know, all the smartphone production is going to be down, television production is going to be down, all the ripple effects on the, you know, the economy and businesses and those kind of things. So yeah. Anyway, who knows?
Well, anyway, I don't mean to talk ill of Knife Center. They've kept me going since 1998.
All right, that's about going to wrap it up. We'll end on that cheery note. The Knife Junkie Podcast number 89. Thanks so much for joining us. We'll have links to the stories that we mentioned here on the show today at thenifejunkie.com/89. Again, if you have any thoughts, comments, questions, 724-466-4487 or email bob@thenifejunkie.com. Bob, I'm going to let you have the final word, being the Knife Junkie, before we wrap it up here.
Well, I would say definitely don't let your stuff rust, because it's hard to bring it all the way back. There are things you can do, but that stain will always be there on that blade. And, you know, that pivot will always be affected. So try not to let the red rust move in, people. Try not to.
Red rust, stay away. For Bob, the Knife Junkie DeMarco, I'm Jim, the Knife Newbie Person. Thank you so much for joining us on the Knife Junkie Podcast.
Thanks for listening to the Knife Junkie Podcast. If you enjoyed the show, please rate and review at reviewthepodcast.com. For show notes for today's episode, additional resources, and to listen to past episodes, visit our website, thenifejunkie.com. You can also watch our latest videos on YouTube at thenifejunkie.com/YouTube. Check out some great knife photos on thenifejunkie.com/Instagram, and join our Facebook group at thenifejunkie.com/Facebook. And if you have a question or comment, email them to bob@thenifejunkie.com or call our 24/7 listener line at 724-466-4487, and you may hear your comment or question answered on an upcoming episode of the Knife Junkie Podcast.